Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the farewell ceremony in honor of the Secretary of the Army, the Honorable Eric K. Fanning. Our host for today's ceremony is the Chief of Staff of the Army. Please stand for the arrival of the official party and remain standing for the presentation of colors and the singing of the national anthem by Master Sergeant Crystal Reams.
Say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Halt, right shoulder,
please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, the Chief of Staff of the Army.
We've got a lot of folks here, and I want to acknowledge a few of them and thank them for coming today to Honor Secretary of the Army, Eric Fanning. We're really privileged to have had Secretary Fanning as our secretary, and I want to thank particularly the DEPSEC DEF for coming, Bob Work. He's not been granted clemency or commutation of his sentence. He'll be here for a little bit longer, but we want to thank you for coming. And Chet Edwards, a great former U.S. Congressman, former representative, thank you also, sir. For coming. I want to thank also Secretary James for being here, Secretary of the Air Force. She's a great supporter of the Army, which we appreciate, and thank you so much for that. Secretary Mabus couldn't make it, but he did pass his regards, and he got a previous commitment, but also want to thank Secretary Mabus. And then, where's Secretary Murphy? There you are. And Secretary Murphy, thank you for being here as the Undersecretary of the Army. There's so many other distinguished folks here. Please forgive me for not calling you out by name, but thank you all for coming. And today's a sad day for all of us in the Army. And it's sometimes the best of times, worst of times. And today's a bit of a sad day because we're saying goodbye to our 22nd Secretary of the Army. And for me personally, I have bonded with Eric Fanning over the time that he's been our secretary, and I feel very close to him. It seems just like yesterday that we were saying goodbye to Secretary McHugh, and Secretary Fanning was there as the incoming acting Secretary of the Army, and then he decided to go AWOL, and he left me. Had something to do with Congress, I'm told. And of course, Secretary Murphy stepped into the breach as the acting Secretary of the Army. And he did that for several months. And by the way, Secretary Murphy did an absolutely outstanding job as the acting Secretary of the Army. And then on 17 May 2016, Eric Fanning came back. And at that point, he was my fourth Secretary of the Army in as many months. So I really appreciate the processes of the United States government and the speed at which we turn nominees. But Secretary Fanning was highly motivated, and he was prepared right from the get-go to take on the hard problems of the Army. And I personally, along with Secretary of Defense and many others, welcomed him on 20 June. Rings eternal. Because Secretary Fanning made it to 248 days, less than the required 365 for a full-fledged painting, but he is going to get a photograph on the wall. But seriously, Secretary Fanning's just been a wonderful secretary. He's made a tremendous impact in a very, very short amount of time. He's clearly had little patience, as the Army staff knows, for PowerPoint briefings and lengthy meetings. He came with a lot of energy, and I remember how quickly he took over the job of being our secretary, and he immediately hopped on a plane and headed to Poland to witness Operation Anaconda, which was the largest Allied exercise conducted in Europe, in this one, Central Europe, since the end of the Cold War. And there he not only showed his support for our allies, but also our troops, but also how the Army trains and how the Army deploys and how critical the Army is to maintaining deterrence. And let me highlight just a couple of other data points. Though he did not log in as many miles traveling as Secretary Mabus, who's not here, but I had to take a jab in his absence, he did manage to quickly travel not only to Europe, but he quickly went to Asia, the Middle East, throughout the entire continental United States, Alaska, Hawaii, to visit our troops and immerse himself into the day-to-day activities of our Army. And he shared it all on social media. So since May of 2016, according to the data provided me by Malcolm Frost, Brigadier General, working on Colonel, Malcolm told me that Secretary Fanning has tweeted more than 801 times, and it almost matches a very famous tweeter that we all know. But he did outdo the Deputy Secretary, who has zero tweets. So score 801 Fanning, zero Wark. He also posted 187 photos on Instagram, almost surpassing Secretary James. He has, no kidding, 465 Facebook entries, three more than Secretary Murphy. And 27,478 followers on Facebook. That exceeds that which follows the Secretary of Defense. So we're very proud. And not only that, but our OGC and Malcolm Frost, our OCPA, in a mere panic just a few days ago, clearly set the bar high for Secretary Fanning and forced themselves to write a social media policy for the entire United States Army as a result. And we thank you for that, and it won't be signed. Seriously, Secretary Fanning, he cares deeply about our soldiers and their families and all of the Department of the Army civilians. These photos and postings and tweets are not done for personal aggrandizement. They're done to inform, and it's a new form of media, and they're done to engage our soldiers throughout the Army. And if you take a quick look at some of those social media posts, you'll quickly recognize how much pride Eric Fanning has in the United States Army. And to ensure that we were informed of what our Army was doing and what the Army leadership was doing to actively engage in solving problems, seeking out resources, and fully committed to the readiness of the Army, Secretary Fanning led us through some incredibly tough resourcing decisions, remaining focused on our efficiency, our competency, our adaptability, and our fiscal responsibilities. He was the right person to do this. He's a very talented executive leader with a wealth of experience in the Air Force, formerly known as the Army Air Corps. And also in the Navy, formerly known as the Coast Guard. And of course, in DOD or OSD, which is actually not formally known by anyone, and not recognized by either the Air Force or the Navy as a federal entity. But Eric Fanning was the right choice. He's the right choice to make the decisions for our Army at a critical time. He understands how the Pentagon works. He understands how the other services work. And importantly, he understands how the Hill and what it takes for the Army to get things done. And part of his desire is expressed in something that he initiated, which is the Rapid Capabilities Office, which is responsible to ensure that we're pursuing the right capabilities for our Army today and tomorrow, and to do it very quickly and to cut through all the red tape with a direct line to the Secretary and myself, with no hurdles to jump and no bureaucracy to get lost in. He led the effort to increase diversity in our Army, ensuring we have access to the best talent, regardless of identity. His personal example of courage and integrity has clearly left its mark. Eric Fanning is a true professional who demands that we treat all with dignity and respect. And most importantly, he has a deep and unbiding concern for our troops, their families, and our civilians. And that was always his constant light. It was evidenced by me on frequent occasions watching Eric Fanning visit our wounded warriors at Walter Reed. He did it with no fanfare and no notice. It was also evident to me when he showed deep compassion for the families of our fallen at Dover or Arlington. Secretary Fanning has set and lived the example of a true professional with incredible grace and civility. His leadership has clearly helped to not only increase our readiness, but it's also made us an overall better Army. Eric Fanning, Secretary of the Army, the 22nd Secretary, on behalf of all the soldiers, the Army civilians, and all of our families, thank you. Thank you for all you've done for our Army. Thank you for setting an example of compassion, of competence, and of courage. And thank you for all you are going to do for our nation in the future. Army strong.
Thank you, General Milley. Ladies and gentlemen, the Deputy Secretary of Defense, the Honorable Robert Work.
Well, that's a hard act to follow, Chief. And what I'd like to do is I'd like to focus, since I knew the Chief was going to focus on Eric's contributions in his time as a Secretary of the Army, I just wanted to talk a little bit more about his contributions to national defense. And so rather than trying to recognize everyone like the Chief, I'd just like to say to all of Eric Fanning's friends, colleagues, mentors, and to the extended Army family, which he has led over the last several months, I would like to thank you all for coming today to recognize Eric's job as 22nd Secretary of the Army. Now, he got interested in politics after growing up in Kalamazoo, Michigan. And he got interest in politics while he was going to Dartmouth, and he was in the 1988 presidential primary working in New Hampshire. And that's where he caught the bug of national service. And so in 1990, after he graduated, he had the opportunity to go and be the research assistant for Les Aspin, who was the chairman of the House Armed Services at the time. And that's a pretty hard job to get into. But as he says, and as he has said several times, the book kind of wrote itself after that. And he has been part of the national security family since 1990, with just a few years out. Spending time with Chairman Aspin, Chairman Aspin, as you know, was selected as Secretary of Defense. And when that happened, Eric came in as a special assistant to the Secretary of Defense, where he spent his time in the building, getting acquainted with the building while seeing it right from the top, from the Secretary of Defense's eyes and view and perspective. And after Secretary Aspin left, he went to the White House, where he was in the liaison political affairs shop in the White House. So throughout the 1990s, he's working either in the executive branch or in the Department of Defense. And then he goes to the business executives for national security, where he's the chief of staff there and does an awful lot of work that's related to national security and is helping the department out. Where I got to know Eric was in 2009. Actually, it was late 2008. I was on President Obama's transition team, and I started to meet an awful lot of people who wanted to come back into the government. And Richard Danzig, who is an acquaintance of both Eric and I, said, hey, you ought to get to know Eric Fanning. So I met Eric at the time, found out about his background, and I was just so impressed with him as a person. Extremely eloquent, very civil, a true gentleman. And to say, hey, this is somebody I'd really like to work with if I ever had a chance to do so. So when I was asked to be the Undersecretary of the Navy, I knew that I was going to have two deputy undersecretaries. That's what I was hoping to have. And one person that was going to tackle all of the things that people really don't like to tackle, efficiencies, business operations, et cetera. So Eric and I had a talk. And lucky for me, he came in as the deputy undersecretary of the Navy, which he served admirably for 4 years. Now, towards the very end of my time, Aaron Connaughton, who was the Undersecretary of the Air Force, got selected to be the Undersecretary of Defense for Personnel and Readiness. So I called Eric in and I said, Eric, what are you thinking about? You ought to think about going for this job, Undersecretary of the Air Force. And he said, hey, I'm interested. So I did everything I could behind the scenes. I can't claim credit for it, but I think a lot of people said, hey, this would be a good choice, going from the Deputy Undersecretary of the Navy to the Undersecretary of the Air Force. Well, as soon as he gets there, the Secretary of the Air Force leaves. And so for 6 months, he's the Acting Secretary of the Air Force. And I said, darn, I wish I would have shifted over to the Undersecretary of the Air Force. And he did a fabulous job as the Acting Secretary of the Air Force. Well, then he went back to his tour as the Undersecretary of the Navy, and in that time, he worked with industry and other agencies. He really focused on space, a lot of emphasis on space, as well as Air Force energy savings programs, helped cut consumption by 10%, and he implemented a plan to reduce the Air Force headquarters staff. It didn't go far enough, Eric, but hey, you tried. And then he was picked to be the Secretary of Defense's chief of staff for a short period of time during the transition while the Secretary was trying to figure out, okay, well, Secretary Carter was trying to figure out, how do I want to run the building? Who are the people I'm going to bring in? And he said he knew that John McHugh was probably going to leave, so he started thinking, well, who could be the Secretary of the Army? And he said, hey, Eric Fanning would be a great Secretary of the Army. He was the Acting Secretary of the Air Force for 6 months. He's already proven himself at that level. This is kind of a natural thing. You know, air, land, battle, hey, it works. And so they said, we have a plan. we're going to make Eric the acting Undersecretary of the Army until he becomes the Secretary of the Army. Well, that didn't work. As the chief said, Congress had other ideas. And then he had another job, which was one of the longest jobs he held in the Pentagon, which was trying to get confirmed as a Secretary of the Army. So he was confirmed in May 2016, as you all know, as the 22nd Secretary of the Army. And let me tell you, he fights for the Army. Every chance he gets in front of the Secretary, he has been one of the Army's biggest proponents. And the only other person who even comes close to him, I think, is the chief. They have done a lot for the Army in the last 8 months to try to make sure that the Army family is taken care of. We all know that it's been tough in terms of resources, but they have fought for every dollar that they could possibly get, and they have done everything they could possibly do to make Army strong. And I cannot believe you're going to let him go after Army beats Navy. Man, oh, okay. But as the chief said, oversaw the Rapid Capabilities Office, also the Army Digital Service. In a relatively short period of time, he made his mark on the Army. And I would just like to echo what the chief said. He feels so deeply about everyone he serves with. When he was in the Navy, he cared deeply about the sailors and the Marines. When he was in the Department of the Air Force, he cared deeply about the airmen and airwomen who serve our great nation. And as the Secretary of the Army, he has cared deeply about all soldiers, wherever they are. On behalf of Secretary Carter, who couldn't be here today, I just want to say thank you for all of us in the Office of Secretary of Defense for the 8 years of service, unbelievable service. I don't know how you're going to write this resume. It's really been a remarkable run. Thank you so much. I have two or three more retirement ceremonies I have to go to, so I will not be able to stay till the very end. But Chief, thank you for allowing me to be part of your ceremony. And Eric, thank you for everything you've done for the nation and for the greatest Army on the planet. Army strong.
Thank you, Mr. Work. Secretary Fanning, will you please join General Milley in front of the flags? Earlier this morning, the Secretary of the Army received the Department of Defense Distinguished Public Service Award from the Secretary of Defense. Ladies and gentlemen, please remain seated during the presentations. The Decoration for Distinguished Civilian Service is awarded to the Honorable Eric K. Fanning for exceptionally distinguished public service to the United States Army from May 2016 through January 2017, while serving as the 22nd Secretary of the Army. As Secretary of the Army, Secretary Fanning was a passionate advocate for fulfilling the country's promises to those who have served, ensuring soldiers, civilians, and families get the resources they deserve, the health care they have earned, and every opportunity to pursue the American dream. His unparalleled experiences in all three military departments and the Department of Defense enabled him to be the driving force behind initiatives to improve both the current and future readiness of our Army. He championed initiatives to improve organizational efficiency across the headquarters Department of the Army and spearheaded the creation of a Rapid Capabilities Office and an Army Digital Service, leveraging the intersection between technology and acquisition to defeat our adversaries both today and in the future. A leader of the highest caliber, he led our institution to improve diversity and improve our ability to recruit the most qualified applicants from across America. Secretary Fanning's courageous leadership, vision and passion, combined with his continuous advocacy and support for our Army, are in keeping with the highest traditions of public service and reflect great credit upon himself and the United States Army. Signed, Mark A. Milley, General, United States Army Chief of Staff. do, sir. The United States Army Leadership Award is presented to the Honorable Eric K. Fanning in recognition of his outstanding leadership, extraordinary concern for our soldiers and their families, and his selfless service to the nation. His outstanding leadership throughout his tenure as the Secretary of the Army is in keeping with the highest traditions of service and is a great credit to him and the United States Army. General Milley will now present a West Point football helmet from the 2016 Army-Navy football game. With a letter from the Lieutenant General, Robert Caslin, Superintendent of West Point. The helmet comes with a letter from Lieutenant General Robert Caslin, Superintendent of West Point, that reads, "On behalf of the entire staff and faculty and the Corps of Cadets of the United States Military Academy at West Point, thank you for your tremendous support to this institution during your tenure as Secretary of the Army. Your leadership has contributed immeasurably to the Academy's efforts in educating, training, and inspiring leaders of character for our Army and has helped to ensure our graduates are prepared to fight and win our nation's wars. Thanks to your support and advocacy, West Point continues to be the world's preeminent leader development institution. As a small token of our appreciation for your leadership and service, on behalf of the Office of the Secretary of the Army, please accept this Army West Point football helmet from our recent victory over Navy. Go Army, beat Navy." Signed, Robert L. Caslin, Lieutenant General, United States Army, Superintendent. General Milley will now present a gift from the HQDA staff, an engraved Monte Grappa ballpoint pen. General Milley is now presenting a print of General George C. Marshall.
So this is for me and Dan Allen, on behalf of everyone in the room, for me daily hand-painted by Guarantee for America. For those of you who don't know, I'm sure everyone in the room does, in my opinion, and I think most of our opinion, General Marshall was probably the finest general officer ever produced by the United States of America, and I think it's a worthy token of our appreciation to you, Secretary, and hopefully he'll watch over you as the time can be here today.
Thank you, General Milley. Ladies and gentlemen, the Secretary of the Army.
Thank you very much. It started to feel like a wake there a little bit about halfway through your remarks, so I appreciate the humor. Thanks, everyone, for turning out today. Master Sergeant Reams, wonderful rendition of the National Anthem. Now you know why I asked for her by name. Congressman Edwards, thank you, as always, for coming out. Too many secretaries to name. It has been, in 8 years, 7 appointments, 7 offices, 8 parking spaces, 9 titles, and 10 moves. Clearly, the secret to success is never staying anywhere long enough for them to realize the mistakes you've made until it's too late. I'm proud of much that we accomplished together while I have been Secretary of the Army, but there are 2 things that stand out. First, due to strange timing, lots of movement in the United States Senate, even though I served as acting secretary of one department and secretary of another, I have never had to testify at a budget hearing. Second, I got to see Army beat Navy. Everybody takes credit for that, but we know it was the uniforms. That helmet was pretty awesome. Arrival ceremonies are all about what you hope to accomplish. Farewells are about thanking, and I have so many people to thank. These final days aren't ending as I'd imagined. I finished all of my substantive priorities. We've opened service to those who meet the requirements but were previously denied the opportunity. We've found ways to more quickly deal with emerging threats and get capability into the hands of soldiers faster. We've forged partnerships with private sector cyber innovators that will vastly increase the Army's organic, offensive, and defensive cyber capabilities in an increasingly complex threat environment. And we found new and creative and fun ways to tell the Army story to new audiences. This week, any anxiety I feel is all about worrying that I've not properly thanked the many people responsible for me being here. So let me get started. And there's no way I can thank everyone, but luckily Katrina McFarland was here last week and reminded me that I can still keep thanking people after I'm gone. But I'm going to do what I can today. I recognize almost everyone in this room and owe each of you a debt of gratitude. But as the deputy said at his recognition ceremony last week, he thought we were up to about 147 farewell ceremonies by Friday. I can only imagine what we've reached by today, so I'll try to be as efficient as possible. With each new opportunity I've been given in this administration, two things become clear. First, it takes an increasingly large village to get me through a day. And I've never been able to figure out if that says more about the position or me personally. But let me start there with my village. First, to all the protocol shops that I've worked with in the last 8 years, and most recently, Michelle and the Army protocol team, thank you for your labor-intensive and detail-oriented work that you pull off over and over again. To the old guard, you make us proud in everything you do. And it's been one of my great honors to see you in action many times over the years. From our great celebrations to the moving respect you pay those who make the ultimate sacrifice. Thank you. PIPFA, who would have thought I would thank the Pentagon Protective Forces? But they're the first people I see when I walk in every morning and the last people I see when I leave. Thank you. To the amazing civilian aides to the Secretary of the Army, over 100 patriotic volunteers around the country, many of whom are here today, who help us tell the Army story and support our soldiers and their families. Thank you for the work you do when we can't even promise that the way we compensate you will push you into another tax bracket. The amazing PSOs who are with me on long days and long trips, thank you for your incredible professionalism and for taking such good care of me, all while being fun to have around. And I don't even know where to begin about the talent across the entire Army headquarters. I'll spare you from going through it name by name. I see so many faces I want to call out, but a particularly heartfelt thank you to my daily stand-up team. At my table every morning, and in my office many times throughout the day, the amazing Patrick Murphy, Undersecretary, partner in crime, who brings energy to everything he does. My chief of staff, Alex Wagner, I hired you to be disruptive. Much to many's dismay, you have far exceeded in my expectations. The dynamic legal duo of Alyssa Starzak and Rob Park, Rudy DeLeon, who's here, who's been my boss in many jobs, gave me this one first piece of advice when I became undersecretary and then actually the Air Force: keep your lawyers close. So it's great to have two lawyers that you like and admire so much. Thank you. Tom Hawley, Deputy Undersecretary of the Army, who worked with Secretary McHugh and Congressman McHugh for many years, and of whom it said, you cannot work hard enough. And I tried, but I didn't succeed. The amazing Director of the Army Staff, Gary Cheek, and the amazing AA, LL, and PA teams led by Jerry O'Keefe, Laura Richardson, and Major General Malcolm Frost. Sure, one day I'm sure to be Lieutenant General. And finally, the incredible immediate office team, IOSA, the immediate office of the Secretary of the Army. All the people in the back offices who think great thoughts and write them down, then develop a plan for me to get out of Washington and spread the story. To the amazing NCOs in the outer office, led with great humor by Jason Eason. To the military assistants and aides in the offices as you get closer to mine. Then finally, to the last line of defense, my exec Trevor Bradenkamp and my assistant Susan Bennett. These two people, along with Alex, experience the full measure of whatever mood I am in during our long days together. Thank you. Now, my second big realization is that it wasn't until my 40s that my professional trajectory looked like it was planned. It's not at all like the deputy described it. It was an assortment of great opportunities that helped lead me here, but weren't strategically linked. But many of the people who helped guide it at just the right moments so that it did become a path which would lead me to this amazing honor, many of those people are here today. First, Rudy DeLeon, as staff director of the House Armed Services Committee, and Larry Smith, who was counselor, who hired me out of school. The deputy had the date a little bit wrong. It was a year later. I had taken a year off to sail in the Caribbean and scuba dive as much as I can, and first met Rudy during markup. And he asked me where I came from. And normally, a new staffer on a committee on the Hill has worked someplace else on the Hill. And all I could think to say was the Caribbean. He literally rolled back his eyes, leaned back in his chair, and called his assistant to take me on a tour of the offices and get back to work. Debbie James, who's like a sister to me, we've known each other over 25 years, worked together in multiple capacities. Debbie hired me into Ben's, Business Executives for National Security, when I was ready to return from my self-imposed exile in New York. Bob Work, who was just here, was instrumental in my return to public life in an administration, in this administration, after Richard Danzig, who couldn't be here today, introduced us. And Michael Donnelly, former Secretary of the Air Force, who picked me to be under and did so and had confidence in me knowing he was leaving in 60 days. He didn't tell me till this deal had been cut. Gave me the opportunity to be acting secretary for a longer period than we realized, which definitely teed me up to then be chief of staff to Secretary Carter and Secretary of the Army. So thank you, Secretary Donnelly, for that. You all are much like bumper pads in the pinball game of my life, keeping me on path all these years, and it's much appreciated. So many more treasured colleagues and friends are here. When you move around as much as I have, you build a lot of important relationships, and I see so many of you here today. But I know we've got to clear the place for the next farewell ceremony. So three more recognitions. First, Bob Speer. Bob and I have known each other for many years, worked together in many capacities, both you in the Army and me across the other services in the Army. And the last time I wasn't testifying for myself, for my own confirmation, was actually with Bob, a great friend, and I think everybody knows already. Bob will be the one Army constitutional official staying at noon on Friday to be the acting secretary and help with the transition. All of you will know instantly when that happens because you'll hear a very large holler from Miami, where I will be at noon on Friday. The chief, Holly Ann. The chief, I want to thank you a lot. I have worked in this building many years. I've seen many chiefs and secretaries. I've seen a lot that didn't work very well. Many of you have heard this story already, but one of the great, unique aspects of my office and the chief's office is they back up to each other and share a common door. We can move back and forth in theory without anybody knowing that we're doing that. And that doesn't exist anyplace else between any other leadership team in the Department of Defense. And that works great sometimes, and it doesn't work so great sometimes. Previous secretaries have put bookcases up in front of the door or large potted plants to prevent the chiefs from coming over. But we knew before it was public that each other were going to have these jobs. You as the chief of staff of the Army, me as the secretary of the Army, God willing, and worked really hard to forge a friendship and a team. And I think it has shown results, and it has made the job much more enjoyable for me. I've said it before, I'll say it again. A day with Mark Milley is sure to be filled with lots of opportunities to learn and even more opportunities to laugh. So thank you for being such a great teammate. Thank you for being such a great chief. Thank you for tolerating whatever it is that I tried to bring to the job and help bring me along when I needed it. Much appreciated. And Ben, I'm not sure I can promise you another year like the one we've just finished, but I'm also not sure you want another like it. Thank you for supporting me through the challenging times and making the good times better. Finally, to all the men and women who wear the uniforms of all the armed forces, and to their families and the civilians who support them, thank you. I have been honored to visit you at installations around the world and come away a little more in awe of you each time. Less than 1% of America is serving, and we ask you who do to do incredible things. And day after day, year after year, you deliver. You are why our military is strong. You are why our country is great. It has been the honor of my lifetime to be your secretary. Thank you. Now, one final thing. In honor of all the services which I've worked with over the years, I've asked that the entire service medley be played today. But for me, the Army song will always have its fitting place of respect as the final song. Thank you.
Secretary Fannin. Ladies and gentlemen, the Armed Forces Medley. Please stand for your respective service song.
Might, and the army goes rolling along. fighting till the battle's won and the army goes rolling along. Then it's hi, hi, hey, the army's on its way. Count off the cadence out and through. For where we go, you will always know that the army goes rolling along.
Ladies and gentlemen, you are invited to congratulate Secretary Fanning in the receiving line. Please remain in your seats until you are released by protocol staff. This concludes today's ceremony.